Carbon capture and storage, eh? What's it all about? Is it, as some claim, a brilliant strategy for combating emissions at source and buying the world some vital time to get to grips with the logistics of the energy transition? Or is it, as others maintain, simply a strategic smokescreen cleverly created by the fossil fuel industry to enable them to keep digging up crude oil and fossil gas for as long as they can possibly get away with it? If it is the first of those two possibilities, then how do the hard economic numbers stack up? I mean, is it cheaper and more effective to bolt carbon capture machines onto the smokestacks of heavy industry and fossil fuel energy generators? Or could that money be more effectively spent on the rapid build-out of renewable infrastructure to replace those polluters instead? It's a complicated question, there's no doubt about it. But as usual, there are plenty of clever bods with calculators and spreadsheets out there who've crunched the numbers in recent months and come up with some conclusions. So we should have a look at that, don't you think? Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. Long-term viewers of this channel will know that I've made several videos over the years looking at carbon capture and storage, and the unrelated but often conflated proposals for what's known as carbon dioxide removal. It's probably worth just quickly recapping why that distinction exists. Carbon capture and storage, or CCS, involves capturing CO2 emissions produced by fossil fuel industrial processes or power plants before those emissions enter the atmosphere. Essentially, it involves an additional and usually quite costly bit of kit that compresses the captured gas and transports it to a storage site where it gets injected deep underground into geological formations to theoretically be stored safely and securely, preventing it from getting into the atmosphere and exacerbating climate change. Carbon dioxide removal, or CDR, is a different thing altogether. The idea here is to remove carbon dioxide that already exists in the atmosphere. You could argue that that's what trees and plants and other vegetation do already, which is true enough. And there is indeed a branch of CDR called bioenergy with carbon capture and storage, or BECCS, where fast-growing crops are managed in huge plantations, then harvested and burnt for fuel, with the resultant carbon dioxide being captured and stored or sequestered in the ground, where, in theory, it gets used up by all the creepy crawlies that live down there, regenerating subterranean ecosystems and making our soils more healthy in the process. I looked at that in a previous video, which you can jump back to by clicking up there somewhere or on the link in the description section. And then there's direct air capture, or DAC, where massive machines suck in enormous quantities of fresh air and send it over a bed of chemicals that react with the carbon dioxide to remove it from the airstream before the cleaned up flow gets released back into the atmosphere. If that carbon dioxide then gets permanently stored somewhere underground, then there's less of it up in the sky to warm the atmosphere up, and the operators have spent an awful lot of money producing nothing whatsoever of any commercial value. Alternatively, the captured CO2 can be combined with hydrogen to make hydrocarbon fuels like jet fuel, which puts all the carbon dioxide back into the air as soon as it gets burnt, but which can be sold on the open market for a healthy profit. I wonder if you can guess which option is currently favoured by existing DAC operators. In its latest reporting cycle, known as AR6, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, or IPCC, produced projections of how the world could stay within 2 degrees Celsius, or preferably only 1.5 degrees Celsius, of temperature increases compared to pre-industrial levels over the course of this century. All of those projections involve hundreds of billions of tons of carbon capture and carbon dioxide removal, virtually none of which actually exists today. In 2024, a total of about 10,000 tons of carbon dioxide was directly removed from the atmosphere via DAC technologies globally, compared to roughly 38 billion tons that was emitted through human activity during the same period. Critics of these technologies have highlighted numerous other challenges to their practicality and efficacy. Bolting carbon capture machines onto industrial smokestacks, for example, adds roughly 25% onto the operational costs of the business. Where it has been deployed, though, at least in about 70% of the cases anyway, the CO2 is sent into depleted oil seams at massive pressure to dislodge stubborn pockets of the black gold, which then gets made into petrochemicals and fuels that get burned, releasing the CO2 back into the atmosphere. There's additional financial incentives to do that as well, at least in the United States. It's a tax allowance called 45Q, and it pays operators between $12 and $17 for every ton of CO2 that gets sent underground. But recent more forensic studies have started to question whether carbon capture and carbon removal technologies really make any economic sense at all. In December 2023, the University of Oxford here in the UK published a report looking specifically at carbon capture and storage. That research found that a heavy dependence on CCS to reach net zero targets by mid-century would be highly economically damaging, costing at least $30 trillion more than a route based primarily on renewable energy, energy efficiency, and electrification. And that was using numbers that the research team said were probably significantly underestimating the difference. The report points out that CCS is not currently being developed, even at the scale envisaged in the IPCC's low CCS pathways. The volume of CO2 being captured and stored around the world has approximately doubled in the last decade to 49 million tonnes per year, but that number would have to increase 13-fold just to reach the lowest bar on the IPCC chart. Achieving the more aspirational goals would require no less than 85 times more CCS than actually took place globally in 2023. And unlike wind and solar power, the cost of which has plummeted in the last decade or so, the cost of CCS hasn't declined at all in 40 years of trying. So the conclusion of the Oxford team is that any government putting CCS at the centre of their national decarbonisation plans risks putting themselves at a competitive disadvantage. 18 months after the publication of that report, the UK Secretary of State for Energy Security and Net Zero, Ed Miliband, put CCS at the centre of Britain's national decarbonisation plans, pledging £22 billion to two CCS hubs in the north of England. Just saying. Anyway, now a new peer-reviewed study has been published by a team at Stanford University, led by Professor of Civil and Environmental Engineering, Mark Jacobson. The study includes no fewer than 149 countries, accounting for 99.7% of total energy-related global greenhouse gas emissions. Jacobson and his team use a bit of good old-fashioned extrapolation to stress test the various carbon capture proposals. In other words, they looked at some rather extreme scenarios to see how the numbers stacked up, using energy data from a 2020 report published by the International Energy Agency, or IEA. Scenario 1 calculates the cost of the so-called business-as-usual model, where we carry on as we are, relying almost entirely on unabated fossil fuels. Scenario 2 looks at business as usual, but with fully deployed carbon capture technologies across all energy sectors. Scenario 3 considers a mix of carbon capture, fossil fuel energy, and an influx of renewables like wind and solar. And Scenario 4 assesses the costs involved if every country transitioned their business as usual all sector energy to electricity and heat obtained from 100% wind, water, solar, and geothermal energy sources. The research also takes into account electricity storage technologies, including conventional hydropower, pumped hydropower, concentrated solar power, battery energy storage, and green hydrogen storage. That last one is arguably the most contentious and will no doubt already be raising alarm bells in the minds of some of you. We'll come back to that a bit later in the video. So, with that important caveat in place, what conclusions did the team arrive at? Well, there's a ton of intricate detail in the paper itself, which would take several videos to really do justice to be honest. But essentially, it all filters down to this chart, showing the projected annual economic, health, and climate costs of each option by mid-century, as expressed in 2020 dollar values. Private energy costs assume a price of $100 per tonne for CCS and $150 per tonne for direct air capture. For the health costs, just over 54% are attributed to air pollution at the point of production, and just under 46% are from wider area air pollution. None of those health costs are applicable in the 100% renewable scenario on the right-hand side here, because there is no air pollution at the point of use for any of those technologies. Climate costs are calculated as the cost of projected annual 2050 energy-related CO2 equivalent emissions multiplied by the social cost of carbon. And if that little summary has your head spinning, trust me, the full explanation of parameters and variables set out in the rest of the paper is an absolute mind blower. Now, at this point in these types of videos, I usually say something like, don't worry, I've left a link in the description section to the main paper so you can scrutinize it at your leisure. But as is so often the case nowadays, the paper is protected behind a paywall. So while the link is there, you'll have to stump up some of your hard-earned cash if you want to read it. The bottom line, though, is that at least according to the Stanford team, in an extreme hypothetical scenario where 149 countries transition their energy to 100% electricity powered by 100% renewables, end-use energy consumption would reduce by 54%. Annual energy costs would decline by almost 60%, and hundreds of millions of air pollution-related illnesses and deaths would be avoided. Now, I did mention the contentious issue of green hydrogen a bit earlier, didn't I? And I should also note that we haven't talked about nuclear power so far today either. In their two business as usual scenarios, the Stanford team assumed that 2.3% of energy would come from nuclear power, and they based that assumption on 2020 global nuclear power output relative to overall global 2050 demand. There are, of course, plenty of folks who argue that nuclear power should play a far greater role in the global decarbonisation challenge, especially now everyone's apparently getting a bit giddy with excitement about the idea of small modular nuclear reactors, which have been billed by their manufacturers as some kind of silver bullet. There are pros and cons to such arguments, and we've looked at most of them in previous videos, so I won't relitigate it all here. Links to those videos are in the description section below, so feel free to jump back and have a look at them if you want to get a deeper dive. As for green hydrogen, which as I'm sure you know is hydrogen made via electrolysis of water rather than from steam reforming methane gas, which is how 99% of hydrogen is currently produced, well, the Stanford paper assumes that it would do all sorts of things in their 100% renewable scenario, including replacing all aviation fuels, decarbonising steelmaking, and storing energy to get us through the winter season. There are plenty of industry experts like Paul Martin, Michael Liebreich and others who argue that those applications are much less likely to happen than the Stanford team suggests. And if this recent announcement by Airbus is anything to go by, those industry experts may well have a point. I'll let you folks argue that one out down there in the comments section. But even with those caveats, research like this and the paper we looked at earlier from Oxford University and several other studies from around the world are all pointing pretty clearly to very significant, possibly crippling costs to national economies that insist on stubbornly pursuing what they see as the short-term cash cow of fossil fuel exploitation. In the not-too-distant future, that strategy may well come back to bite them, and bite them hard.
Drill, baby, drill.
Anyway, as I say, feel free to dive down there to the comment section to vent your spleen if you feel so inclined, and I'll be very interested to have a look at some of your views. In the meantime, that'll do us for this week. Thanks as always to the amazing folks over at Patreon who keep the content on this channel completely independent and enable me to keep ads and sponsorship messages out of your way. And I must just give a quick shout out to some folks who joined recently with pledges of $10 or more a month. They are Ains, Rowan Kilby, Carl Brandon, Christoph Zivicki, Jonathan Osman, Ben Curtis, F, and Andrew Burnett. If you feel you'd like to join those people in supporting the work I do here at Just Have a Think, then jump over to patreon.com/justhaveathink to find out how you can join the team and have a look at all the exclusive perks you can get there, including additional Patreon-only videos and monthly content polls. And if you find these videos helpful and informative, then you can hugely support the channel simply by hitting the subscribe button on YouTube and clicking on all notifications. It's completely free to do that, but it really does help us get noticed by the AI algorithm, which means you get to see more videos like this one each week. Dead easy to do. It's just a couple of clicks, either down there somewhere or on that icon there. Most important of all though, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.